Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Nikhil Sinha. I'm the Vice Chancellor of Shiv University. And welcome to the first of a series of lectures on India and the world. The lecture series in partnership between the Shiv University and the India International Center seeks to take the most prominent and significant issues that the country faces at this time and to contextualize them in understandings of the way these issues and problems are being dealt with internationally and globally. My job today is to thank the people who organized this event and to get out of your way as quickly as I can. But I never missed the opportunity to put a plug in for the Shiv University, and I'd like to give you one little introduction to the university. We are a comprehensive, multidisciplinary research university. We are the first such university created in the private sector in India. We are a philanthropic institution supported entirely by the Shiv Foundation. We're comprehensive because we offer undergraduate, master's, and PhD programs in every discipline. We're multidisciplinary because all the way from professional programs like engineering and management, and humanities and social sciences, and natural sciences, programs are offered at the university. And shortly we will also have programs in law. We already have a program in art design and performing arts as well, in communication and education. And we are a research university in that we are committed to the dissemination to the generation of new knowledge and creative and forms of creative expression, and not simply the dissemination of new knowledge. We are located about an hour and a half from here. If any of you would like to visit, we would love to have you come to the university and meet with the faculty and students. Many of them are here today. I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the India International Center for working with us to organize the series. In particular, Mr. Soli Sarabji, the chairman of the India International Center. Of course, Imash and Ravish Verma, who's very kindly joined us this evening, members of the Advisory Council, and most of all, Pramila Ghosh, where are you, Pramila? Oh, there you are at the back. Thank you so much. Your time and efforts are critical in making this event happen, so we thank you very much. I'd also like to thank the Trinity University team who made this happen, of course. The lecture series is offered under the aegis of the Center for Public Affairs and Critical Theory. That is our center that bridges the divide, we hope, between academic and public policy discourse. It's headed by Dipankar Gupta. Professor Shubhashree Gangopadhyay, the director of our School of Humanities and Social Sciences. And Shadiq Puri, without whose efforts none of these events are possible at SNU. Thank you all very much. Thank you for coming, and over to you, Shubhashree.
Thank you, Nikhil. We are extremely delighted that all of you have been able to come today. We, as Nikhil explained, we are trying to have this series in a sense to be able to say that there is a lot that we can learn from experiences elsewhere, but at the same time it is important for us to be able to figure out what experiences we can learn from and what experiences we cannot simply copy, because the context in which we are trying to have these policy reforms are very, very different in different countries. You know, at HSS, or sorry, SNU-IIC, that is to say, the Pronab Sen University School of Humanities and Social Sciences, we strongly believe that in social policy or social reforms, there are some things that are very generic and can be applicable to any society, but there are other idiosyncratic experiences of societies that need to be kept in mind, and what we can get from there is the is an, the description of the forces, description of the model that works behind them, so that we can apply them to our own context. Right? So that was the purpose with which we put this series together, and we are delighted that our first speaker is Pranab Sen, ably chaired by TN9. I hand it over to Nine.
Thank you, Subhashish, and good evening, friends. Month-long lecture series sounds like a great idea, and none better than Dr. Pranab Sen to kick off the series. I have a very simple way of describing Dr. Sen, which is that I don't know of anybody who combines the range of subjects on which he knows a hell of a lot with the depth and detail with which he seems to know about all of them. I've heard him speak before, and he goes all over the place, and he's a master of detail in all of them, and it's very impressive. So when you have a subject like dimensions of interaction between rural and urban India, you can go again across a wide canvas, and I wait, like all of us, to see how he develops the themes in that broad framework. I think you have his CV already circulated, so I'm not going to go into it, except to say that he's held some very senior positions before his present position as country director at the International Growth Center. He was the chief statistician. He's chairman of the Statistics Commission. He spent long years in the Planning Commission. Jairam Ramesh has a well-earned reputation for being an ace drafter, but he has mostly drafted speeches and position papers, to the best of my knowledge, whereas the real ace drafters here plan documents, assessments, midterm appraisals, policy frameworks, much more detailed, substantive documents. They've all been drafted by him while sitting in the background and not attracting attention to himself, which I think is one reason why he does have that encyclopedic knowledge on a whole range of subjects in enough detail to be able to hold attention. So, Dr. Sen, over to you. I would request if you can speak. It's about 6:40 now, and if you speak for about 45 or 50 minutes, we'll get to about 7:25, 7:30, and that'll leave us half an hour for questions and closing. Thank you.
Thank you, Ninan, for the kind words. But let me begin by saying how honored I am to have been asked to actually kick off this series. It puts a little bit of strain on oneself, because in a sense, I think you're expected to set the stage for what happens in the lectures to follow. The second thing that I would like to say is that winters in Delhi are a time for seminars and lectures. I mean, we spent probably the four and a half months of fall and winter in Delhi basically hopping from one venue to another, mostly at the IIC, although it seems to be the most popular place for these things. And therefore, to actually come and speak at IIC rather than listen and comment is again an honor, and I thank SNU for honoring me this way. Before I begin, I'd like to make it very clear that I am no expert on urbanization in any sense. I'm not an urban economist, and I certainly know nothing about urban planning. What actually drew my attention to the issue of urbanization, and which in a sense will form the bedrock of this particular lecture, is that over the 20 odd years that I've been at the policymaking level in government, almost every government scheme which was aimed towards improving the living standards of rural India were justified not on the basis of the human development impact of these schemes. They are always couched in one specific phrase, which was reduce migration. I mean, this has been an obsession in government in India. And it's an obsession which I was a little puzzled about. And so, being curious, I started to look around and see what was the global experience, what was the attitude towards urbanization around the world. And the results were actually quite remarkable, which is that by and large, for most countries, except a few countries in Africa, most countries looked on urbanization as a good thing. Whereas we looked on urbanization as something that was to be avoided, if at all possible, by the government. Which raises the question, why? Why is this? And why is this attitude so all pervasive? This is not just within the government. I suspect a lot of you also probably think the same way. One possible answer is what Mahatma Gandhi said, the soul of India lives in her villages, and we want to preserve that soul. But all of us, I think, are literate enough to know what the global experience with urbanization is. And the global experience with urbanization is that growth and productivity are very closely and very strongly linked to the process of urbanization. Societies which tend to stay rural also tend to be not very fast growing. And these dimensions are strikingly large. The average difference in productivity between urban areas and rural areas, if you take the global experience, can range anywhere from 40 to 50% to 6 to 7 times, depending on which country you're dealing with. Right? And there's also another dimension, which is as urban areas grow in size, the productivity actually goes up. And again, the relationship is strong, it's tight. And what it says in effect is as an urban area doubles in size, productivity goes up somewhere between 5 and 7%. So you think of an urban area comprising of 100,000 people, if it grows to 1 million, then the productivity of every worker in that city would have gone up by about 50 to 70%. Right? These are phenomenal numbers. Why is it that we as a country, we in our not merely political discourse, but in the economic discourse as well, we tend to understate the importance and the effect of urbanization? It's certainly not the case, I think, that in the Indian context, the spiritual need coming out of the soul of India trumps economic need. I don't think any Indian politician is quite as spiritual as all that. Mahatma Gandhi was, but I seriously doubt that any of the others are. So, what is going on? The second question was, so this is the political and the intellectual discourse. But the people out there, why aren't they moving? After all, we are not China. I mean, we don't have a hukou system in this country. If somebody wishes to move from rural areas to the urban areas, he can do so, and there's no legal bar to him doing so. Why don't they move? This has been a puzzle in India of long standing. I actually went and trolled through the 5 years plan since the fourth 5-year plan. Prior to that, there was no talk of urbanization in Indian planning. But since the fourth 5-year plan, every plan has made an estimate of how much rural to urban migration would take place over the course of the plan, and therefore, how should you think about urbanization? And since the fourth plan till the 10th plan, after which we stopped making these estimates, we went spectacularly wrong. At that time, we were talking about the rate of rural to urban migration being somewhere around 6 to 7% a year. By and large, you are lucky if you look at the census data, if that migration is 2-2.5% or less. What's even more startling is that the rate of migration has actually been slowing in India. I talked about the countries of Africa. Countries of Africa started slowly, but they've all ramped up. Now, except for a handful of African countries, most of them have got urbanization rates which are higher than ours. So the rate of urbanization is very rapid. In India, it's slow and reducing. It becomes even more problematic when you actually look at the reason for migration. And you find that the overwhelming reason for migration, that is the largest chunk of people who have migrated, have done so because of marriage. Okay? Take that out and assume that the rest have migrated for economic reasons. And it looks really bad. The other fact is we tend to think of migration as people leaving their home villages and coming to the cities for a better life, right? Surprise. The bulk of migration in India is rural to rural. It is not rural to urban. People in rural India are moving within rural India. Why they do it, how they do it, that's something which has actually not been studied. It's gone completely under the radar screen of all policymakers at all points in time in this country. But rural to rural migration is about 3 times larger than rural to urban migration. So there's something happening. We know, for instance, that in India, the level of urbanization is about 36%. And it's growing slowly. When we actually start looking at the data a little more carefully, we realize that even the slow growth of urban India is almost entirely organic. Rural to urban, net rural to urban migration accounts for less than 20% growth of urban India. Less than 20%. The remaining 80% comes from organic growth. It comes either through the natural growth rate of the population that is resident in those urban areas, or it comes from an urban agglomeration actually simply swallowing its neighboring villages, or it comes from this wonderful thing called the census town, which in the last, the 2011 census, has in fact been the largest source of urbanization in India. So when we talk about urbanization, when I'm talking about urbanization now, I am not thinking necessarily about urban bodies in terms of their governance structure. I'm talking about urban in the sense of definitions, and the definitions that are used by the Census of India. For a moment, let's talk a little bit about these definitions, because they do matter, and it's something I will come back to towards the end of my presentation, but do keep it in mind. We use 3 criteria. The first is population density. The second is the size. And the third is the proportion of adult males who are not engaged in agriculture. And using these 3 criteria simultaneously, we come to this figure that I've just quoted. There are studies which show that most countries use either 2 or even 1 definition. If we start looking at India through these definitions that other countries have been using, India actually looks hugely urban. If we use, for instance, the most popular definition, which is density, lo and behold, India is 70% urban, right? But our governance systems, the urban governance systems, apply to less than 30%. Now, this is an important consideration, which I will come back to, because in a sense, that's the closing theme. Let me just take you through the way economists have thought about the processes. And much of this discussion dates back to 1954, the classic paper by Sir Arthur Lewis, where he posited the existence of a dynamic, high productivity industrial sector, which is urban in character, and a relatively low productivity, low accumulation sector, which is the agricultural sector in the rural areas. And naturally, because of high productivity in industry, it attracts people from the rural areas, which feeds the need for the industry that the industry has for workers. And this is the process that drives urbanization and growth. The Lewis model actually fits remarkably well to the experiences of most of the developed countries around the world. But in most of the developing countries, or at least a very large portion of it, it doesn't work quite as well. The reason for that, I think, was expounded many years after Sir Arthur Lewis, which was, I think, in the late 60s, or maybe very early, I think 68 or 69, there's this paper by Harris and Todaro, which says that there's actually an intermediary step. That is, a person who leaves the rural area and comes to the urban area doesn't automatically get absorbed in the industrial sector, and usually ekes out a subsistence in the informal urban economy. And that's the via media through which the transfer takes place. There's been a fair amount of work on the nature of this informal urban economy. And what it suggests is that the informal economy is where the rural worker who has migrated really does the learning which is necessary for him to be able to plug into the industrial system. And the informal sector provides him with the earnings that he will need to be able to support himself through the learning process. So the informal sector is very important. I'm not going to the whole Harris-Todaro bit. I mean, there are probabilities involved. None of that is important. What is important is to recognize the importance of the existence of this informal urban sector. So think of the Indian economy then as essentially comprising of three sectors: the rural sector at large, the urban informal economy, and the urban formal economy. By and large, as I think most of us know, the rural economy by itself, that is, if I take out the so-called census towns, which are in no sense industrial, what it will come to is roughly about 62% of India is rural. Then you would have a chunk which would be the urban informal, which would be about a little over 20%, and the rest is the more formal urban, which is what everybody is aspiring to. That's roughly how it breaks down. So the process that Harris-Todaro talks about and the process that we are seeing out here is the process by which somebody in the rural area, when he looks at the option of moving to urban areas, of migrating, He doesn't really look at what the guy is earning in the Maruti factory. What he looks at is what are his brethren who are in the urban informal sector, what is it that they are earning? And whether it makes sense for him to take that plunge. So it matters a great deal as to what are the standards of living, not so much in urban area on average, but the informal component of the urban areas vis-a-vis the rural areas. If you think of it this way, and instead of comparing the urban areas on average, which have relatively low proportion of the formal, but with very, very high numbers in terms of lifestyle, productivity, whatever you have. Look at what is happening in the informal sectors in India, and then ask the question, is the average Indian better off staying in the village or moving? And the answer, surprisingly, is that the rural Indian is a perfectly rational human being. He'd be a complete idiot to move to the cities. In parameter, across parameter, including economic parameters, that is, if you make appropriate adjustments for cost of living, you are better off being poor in rural India than being poor in urban India. This is true of economics, it's true of health, it's now getting true of education, although that didn't used to be the case. It's certainly true as far as crime is concerned, that is, sense of security that you have. And so we have gotten into an equilibrium where, because of the non-dynamism, as it were, of informal urban India, we as a country are not following the processes that led to development and growth in large parts of the world. We've come to some kind of, perhaps a very undesirable kind of equilibrium, where no matter how bad things are in rural India, they get worse if you move. Now, in this context, at the heart of this whole understanding of informality is really the issue of slums. Slums. Again, if one looks at the public discourse on slums, we are terribly ashamed of them. We think they're terrible things. We think they should not exist. We do our utmost to prevent slums from happening. The fact is, again, globally and over time, in every country, slums have been a natural corollary to the process of urbanization. Not only can you not do without slums, you should not do without slums. Because when a person is moving from a rural area to an urban area, then almost by definition, he or she shall not have the economic wherewithal to be able to afford to live in anything other than a slum. Slums start vanishing when the balance between the rural and the urban happens. Usually, depending upon which country you're dealing with, this happens when the urban population exceeds 80% of the population. The total country's population, usually maybe even lower than that. Until then, slums will exist and will continue to exist. After that, most of the migration that you get is really urban to urban, and so the affordability issue is a little less. But there's then the issue of how do we think about slums? What do we do with them? As I said, we are ashamed of them. But that's only one part of it. So if you think of the way we talk about slums in India, we talk about slums as being essentially a blot on the urban landscape. And therefore, you have to do something for those slums, if for no other reason, just to make your own existence a little more pleasant. That, by and large, is the way we think and talk about it. The question is, do we or have we ever thought about slums as the locations in which the learning and earning behavior of recent migrants happen? Do we actually try and facilitate that process? And the answer is no, we don't. We do exactly the opposite. So if you think about, for instance, notions of providing basic education and healthcare, which are intrinsic to the process of learning, when we think about how people actually pick up skills, how people learn to exist in an urban framework, we do not think about providing these upfront. We do it kicking and screaming. So in a sense, what has happened is that given the way we have discussed the problem, we have settled into a very unpleasant equilibrium. And the question is that, number one, do we need to break out of it? Number two, how do we break out of it? Let me again now go back to what I had talked about. Think about the process of urbanization. Supposing I have a situation where I have a very tight definition of urbanization, right? So I use these three criteria and say 36% of my population in urban areas. Of that 36%, only 28% are covered by urban governance structures. This is what we've done. What it means in effect is that you have large areas and very large numbers of people who are in effect living an urban existence without the urban governance structures that he needs to be able to live that existence. And this can proceed for a long time. If we use, for instance, the most popular definition, as I said, 70% of India is urban. So you have a very large number of people who are leading an urban existence with all its ills, without the benefits that urban governance structures bring. And therefore, we really need to think about the issue that if we are going to address the question of governance, when do we begin? Do we wait until things become so apparent that we are forced to then define it as a municipal area and provide the urban governance structures? Or do we begin well before that? That's number one. Number two, do we have a system where there is a smooth transition between rural governance structures and urban governance structures? The problem is we don't think about it that way. Again, if you think about the notions of what a panchayat is supposed to do and what an urban local body is supposed to do, the panchayat is expected to, by and large, do much less. Nothing much is expected out of them. We do not, for instance, have rules which say that any village above a particular size must follow a particular set of guidelines in terms of how they are structured. These are applied the moment you are recognized as an urban area. So the transition is anything but smooth. But now, when we talk about slums, the definition of slum that is used in our measurement, which is basically kaccha houses, lack of sanitation. There are two main criteria. Right? Every village in India is a slum, by definition. Moment I extend my municipal boundaries to the neighboring villages, by definition I've got new slums. These are not the same as the slums that come up as a result of rural to urban migration. These are settled areas. Nobody is getting dislocated, right? But what happens in terms of the way we think about it? One slum is as good or as bad as another. And perhaps the needs are roughly the same. But settled areas where you have already had at least some form of organization require far less hand-holding than a slum which has come about from dislocation. And perhaps in the way we think about things, we need to be able to distinguish between these two categories. We need to have finer gradations of classification. This abrupt rural to urban transition is good for neither. And it certainly is not good for people. So how do we think about it? At what point of time do we try and create the initial, or should I say, experiences of getting a rural area used to the kind of governance systems they would need to have once they become urban? When do we begin and how do we begin it? If you look at rural India today, the bulk of decision making in terms of development is done essentially by the bureaucracy. The panchayats are self-governance systems, certainly. But if you think of what is it that they're expected to cover, it's really quite limited. Very little of infrastructure, very little of the ability to maintain infrastructure is really with the local body, with the panchayats. Almost all of this is done through a state bureaucracy. When the transition happens, things become exceedingly messy. Because then self-government actually takes on some kind of a meaning. And this transition doesn't happen easily. It's painful and it's very disruptive. So the question that we really need to ask ourselves is that if we are really to follow the lessons that we have that have been learned from the experiences of the developed countries, we are not going to be developed until we are far more formally urban than we are today. We are largely informally urban today, but we need to move to formal, to a level of formal urbanization. We are not a China. We cannot have a situation like they did in China where they decided to develop vast tracts of land and then one day issued an order saying 110 million people shall move from rural to urban areas in the next 10 years. Done. The infrastructure was in place and people moved. We will have to live with a much more organic system, which means that we need to be able to plan every step. We need to be able to identify the constraints to the transition and to smooth it over. It requires an extremely high degree of planning. And the question that we really need to ask ourselves, do we have the capacity to do so? I don't know how many of you are aware that as a country, we have very, very few. When I had looked at it really closely, which was several years in the past, we had only two formal departments of urban planning in the entire country, of which one at that point in time was in the School of Planning and Architecture in Delhi, which had a single student. So if somebody asked that, can we plan a new Chandigarh? We don't have the capacity. We cannot. Forget about a Chandigarh. The problems of urban planning in places which are already settled are much more difficult. You require much higher degrees of understanding of urban plans. Look at the problem, for instance, that Chandrababu Naidu is having in planning Amravati. He's got his entire team from outside. For a country where we are looking at 600, 800 cities, forget about towns, those are the kind of numbers we are looking at. We simply do not have the capacity to plan it. And we haven't even begun the process. Not only have we not begun the process, the point is, if you think of the people who man our so-called urban planning departments in the government, most of them are essentially civil engineers with very little idea as to what planning is all about. They know construction. They know how things should be built. They don't know why should they be distributed in a particular way. This is a recognition which, oddly enough, doesn't seem to have sunk into us at all. And we've been at this game now for 60 years. We plan all manner of things. What we cannot and do not and will not be able to do, at least in the near future, is do any kind of meaningful urban planning. And by urban planning, I don't mean planning for the metros. That's a problem enough. I mean urban planning from the day a particular location, a particular village, starts acquiring the characteristics of an urban area. That's the level at which you have to start planning from. We don't have the wherewithal to do it. We have to look for assistance. And it's becoming actually quite ridiculous. Ever since Mr. Modi announced smart cities, I am told that the large consulting companies have been scouting the world around to find people who can come in and help us in designing smart cities, because there is no local talent available. That is where we are at. At the heart of all of this is, again, what I started out with, which is a mindset which says people are better off in villages. Maybe true. There are, I think, game-changing influences that are happening because of technology. The mobile revolution has made a very large chunk of the benefits of urbanization already significantly weaker. But it certainly cannot and will not ever be able to take care of the other dimensions of urbanization which lead to high productivity and growth. And what are these dimensions are fairly obvious. It is that when you have people together, you have deep markets for labor and for products. What you also have is the ability of companies to go in for tight specialization, for a much higher degree of division of labor, all of which are essential attributes to increasing productivity. These will not happen just because of the communication revolution. You still need the propinquity that comes with another way. And you need to be able to make it work. So in terms of how we think about it, what I would suggest very strongly is focus on the intermediate point. And that intermediate point is the informal urban economy. Look at our plans. Look at any of our plans. You will find there's a lot that goes into the formal sector. In fact, most of our policies are aimed at the formal sector. There's an even larger amount which is aimed at the rural economy, but the urban informal economy is just mentioned in passing. We have no attitude towards it in an important sense. We don't know what to do with it. And I think we'd better start the process where we situate the urban informal economy exactly where it belongs. It deserves to be, which is at the center stage of our development strategy. Sure, we must develop rural India. But if we are to get the kind of growth that we need and we deserve, then we must make sure that we do not get into a situation where the urban informal sector becomes so unattractive that the benefits of urbanization completely bypass the sector. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a stimulating lecture with a lot of very interesting numbers. I have quite a few numbers which raise questions in my mind, but rather than kick off with my questions, let's so does open the floor, and if the questions flag, then I'll toss you one of them by one. So yes, please.
And Dipankar Gupta, thank you very much. It was really a wonderful experience. And I would like to kind of look at the numbers you presented with both other numbers, which is also, which are also state figures, as well as what is loosely called anecdotal experience. In most villages, I know, there's a huge spurt in education, as you mentioned. In fact, the increase in wage literacy is higher in rural India than urban India. There's also a huge increase in the number of private schools. And what is most striking is that there are so many households, some say 30%, some stop at 15 to 17, households which are female-headed. 13% growth the last census was of rural India, 31% urban India. In terms of actual numbers, urban India just about pips rural India the post. 18 new million towns, 72 new class one, and 2,774 something census towns. So there is apparently a move from rural to urban, which we can't quite grasp. One of the reasons being rural to rural. Now, I'm just putting this idea to you. It may sound quite flaky, but when we say non-urban or urban, the way urbanization understood today and the way people lead lives, should we call them non-agricultural perhaps? If we look at the RNFE, the way it is growing, the fact that large number of of rural workshops actually spring up in backward villages, not forward villages. There's a move to get away, but there is no place they can go to. And the growth in urbanization is much greater in smaller towns than in metropolises. You're quite right there. So has the growth of slums been. So your intermediate point is very important. You know, the growth of the informal sector in the formal sector, for example, which the government of India had a study of that, and they did nothing about it. Arjun Sengupta led. So how does one, you know, understand these numbers and aspiration? Because you say rational villages should live in the village. But the aspiration seemed to be from quote-unquote anecdotal experiences, and also from the increase in rural urban figures, that they want to go to the city, and they find hope in slums and despair in the rural areas.
The diversification of livelihood in rural India has been there for a while. Earlier, it used to be the case that in rural India, something like 70% of livelihoods would come from agriculture. That's now sub 50%. And if you really look, unfortunately, the NSS doesn't ask enough, but if you talk with the NSS investigators, what you get is a very interesting number. NSS asks for only three occupations. What they say is in the rural India, most people have five occupations over the course of the year, okay? Of which only one is an agricultural occupation. So a lot of stuff is happening in rural India, which is non-agricultural. The reason I use the term urban is ultimately it's the governance structure which will determine whether or not that particular geographical location will follow the processes that lead to urbanization and, you know, the growth of productivity. So when you talked about education, for instance, as people shift out of agriculture towards more and more non-agricultural pursuits in the rural areas, the need for education and the utility of education becomes that much greater. And therefore, there is a natural and a normal desire to go for it. That apart, again, think of Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan is really a rural program, although technically it covers every child, right? But in urban areas, you get the following problem, which Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan essentially stated that no child should be more than 1 kilometer away from school. Point is, in urban areas, every child is within 1 kilometer of a school, but he may not have access to that school. In rural areas, you've constructed a school there. So as I said, you know, these are problems where you are getting tied up in your own definitions. And that's something we really need to break out of.
Dear, thank you. I'll ask you two questions. One is your reaction to this comment as an urban citizen. I've noticed in many of our highly urbanized states, like Maharashtra, Gujarat, that there used to be an urban political constituency with people who relied on people in urban areas to vote for them. Mm-hmm. Very good example of that in Maharashtra, in my state, is SK Party, Bombay, my own city. Bombay has not had an urban leader who fights for Bombay since, I would say, about 19, since Rajiv Patel, since 1980, you know. The same seems to be true of many other places. And the way people go out into these informal areas, you're saying, and look for votes, sort of fits things that happen in rural areas. They're not looking at urban futures, they're looking at rural coalitions. That could lead to another kind of political low-level equilibrium, you know, with, and to what extent do you think that this is either a manifestation of or a cause of the urban conundrum you say? Second question is a short one, which is that, you know, if you're going to put the informal sector at the heart of planning, then how would we devise a macroeconomics that does so? What would that mean in terms of our traditional, you know, macroeconomic aggregates, then translate into well-being aggregates? When we say that, because there are questions there. I mean, do you follow the British model and plan for livelihoods based on demand for jobs? Or do you go the supply side route and create conditions where people emigrate and hope that livelihoods will follow people coming in. There are interesting macroeconomic choices that I'm not sure that we have the economic theory, or maybe I'm wrong.
You're wrong.
Question. Yeah, to do it. So, do we have the economic theory to do this?
Yes. Just, you know, the problem is we try to be so accurate in our readings, we forget what we read before. There is this wonderful macroeconomic text by Miller called The Labor Surplus Economy. It works out the full macroeconomics of what we're talking about. No, of a labor surplus economy, of which informal sector is an intrinsic part. The macroeconomics is worked out largely. We can take it forward, and he doesn't put numbers on it. So how you convert it into a sort of computable macroeconomic model is a different issue. But the basic theory exists to a large extent. As far as the politics is concerned, now this is really the important issue. The way our system is organized, the political system sees quote-unquote rural India as being its core base, and the urban areas as being areas which need to be captured for economic reasons of the party. And I think this is ubiquitous. It's practically all states seem to have the same problem. The fact that the rural areas are exhibiting urban characteristics is either lost on them, or they deliberately suppress it because their particular vote bank politics requires you to discourse it differently. I don't know, but I suspect that that's the case.
Rajiv, three comments. One, when you talked about the rationality of staying in the village, right? A lot of people move to the city and are willing to make sacrifices so that their children can have better lives. So that's really a multi-generational motivation that you might have to think about. A second is, you quoted Gandhi. There's also Ambedkar about villages being cesspools of prejudice
that's
and
right.
discrimination. So people, there's a whole category of people who want to escape from the social implications of all that. And the third really is that government used to be a major hirer of people, and that used to absorb people partly through reservations and others from rural India. And that has come down, and maybe that's having some impact on this whole attraction. Just comments that I wanted to give.
Yeah, all well taken. But you know, as I said, the real point is that rural-urban migration isn't that much at all. That's at the heart of the problem. You know, think about it. The slum population in India, with this extensive definition of slums, which the census does, is only 18%. At our level of development, people should be coming in droves. Slum populations in developed countries, and when they were at our stage of development, the slum population would be upwards of 40%. And this, as I said, is an extensive definition where when I absorb a village, I actually classify it as a slum. So this is the thing. People really aren't moving that much. The ones who are moving are very visible to us. But I think that it's the visibility of rarity rather than ubiquity.
Three decades of planning, a time when people like Pranab's father and I had something to do with planning. The propositions are very simple, that the large majority of the people were poor and they were in the rural areas, the middle classes lived in the towns, and they had social services. Therefore, all priorities should be given in investment to the poor and the therefore the rural. It is as simple as that. In fact, if you could recall, there was a book written by Michael Lipton about urban bias in India's planning, accusing us of being excessively influenced by middle class opinion. And I must say that I shared that to some extent when I was in planning. It always irked me that so much investment was made in Delhi, Delhi's urban infrastructure, and so little in rural infrastructure. That's history. The second part is about development theory, that the Lewis model and so on, it was always assumed, it still is assumed, that development means moving from low productivity to high productivity. This is from essentially from agriculture to industry. Now, in this transition, that there could be a third intermediate stage, as Nadar, you mentioned, really never gripped anybody's imagination, simply because we looked at Japan. The intermediate artisanal kind of activity, informal activity, died out with further development. And that was considered the natural tendency. So one hoped that that is what was going to happen. But it didn't happen, and it's never going to happen. It's going back to Lewis again, because of large populations. So neither in China, and China hasn't been able to overcome this problem either. They have this large but permanent low productivity informal sector. We came to recognize it officially only with Arjun Sen Gupta.
Thank you. That was wonderful. I just had a quick question for you. I just wanted to ask you, why do you think there have been such few studies on small town India? So for example, Palanpur has a longitudinal big study. So in the small town category and smaller, I would say RDE, and actually if you start counting, it's literally on one hand or less. And that would give us a totally different picture on the development within India. So can you just reflect as a researcher on what has stopped a lot of researchers from having their pitching their heads?
I think the reason is that the questions are not clear. What is the hypothesis? At the end of the day, when a researcher goes down there, he or she goes armed with a set of hypotheses that is going to be investigated. So when you do village studies, I think the hypotheses are very clear. You know, sociologists, anthropologists, economists, everybody and his grandfather has actually laid out the hypothesis, and you go out and measure. On the pure urban side, again, the hypotheses are fairly clear. The gray area in the middle, what are the hypotheses? I don't think we've reflected on that enough. And without that, you're not going to get research studies, actually.
But, you know, if I can come back to the question here, I thought he was questioning your argument that being urban means higher productivity, if I understood it right. That if there is a low value-added informal sector operating in large segments of our towns and cities, then where does your argument about so it sort of questions your argument.
No, it doesn't. See, that's basically the argument I was trying to make also. That ultimately the equilibrium is not between the rural India and formal urban India. The equilibrium is between rural India and informal urban India. Right? So if I have a low productivity informal urban India, I'm going to hit the equilibrium very quickly.
You know that?
You'll hit the equilibrium very, very quickly. Because then people will not move. And that's, I think, the point that's been made.
Thank you.
previous question. So, from the talk, which I thought was really interesting, there are two sort of policy takeaways in a sense. One is place the informal urban at the heart. Now, in terms of geographically locating the informal urban, are we looking at small and medium towns, or are we looking at the informal urban in larger cities and urban agglomerations? So, just because, you know, the previous, I mean, a lot of that is actually looking at the small and medium town, and is that going to be locus of a new kind of urbanization? Are they going to grow? Or are we really looking at the informal urban in metropolitan cities as well, which is also huge, and the informal urban in, you know, other contexts? I'm just looking for a geographical sort of spatial location for how we start to think about this, because that will then also lead to, you know, finding research questions and thinking about how we approach it. That's the first. The second was, you know, your, I think, very provocative idea that if we redefine the urban, then a lot of rural India can also be absorbed into thinking about it and what would change with the governance systems and governance structures. But how would those governance structures link to the informal economy or the informal urban? Surely, I mean, maybe it's the intersection of thinking about governance, but also then the informal urban in relation to governance, which might then prove catalytic. You know, because otherwise just imagining urban governance systems in, you know, otherwise what we look at as rural areas might not, you know, make that link. So I'm looking for the, you know, sort of the economic link.
Yeah, that is a problem, okay? It is quite clear that in our urban areas, the informal urban is in fact becoming the dominant political force in terms of its vote share. But whether they're able to articulate what their needs are in a cohesive way, which the middle and the upper middle class is very much capable of doing, is really the question mark. I mean, it isn't clear that that category of people had actually given rise to an indigenous leadership which can articulate their needs and aspirations. So my worry is that whereas we do see a lot of leadership emerging in rural areas, urban leadership is coming essentially from the class that already has it. And therefore the articulation is the problem. The geographic location, what I would suggest is really instead of starting the small town metropolis business, look at peripheries of cities. They're natural experiments for you.
Providing urban amenities to rural areas. So if we have to implement it successfully, then how would it change the entire mechanism or the structure of rural-urban migration, barring the reason which you gave of marriage and rural to rural? Barring this incidences, the rest of migration which take place. So how far it would affect the migrations overall?
You know, I think a lot of people completely misunderstood what Dr. Kalam was saying. Okay, what Dr. Kalam was saying is that the advantages of the urban area, why economic activity tends to concentrate in urban areas, let's try and replicate some of those characteristics, not in a village, but in a cluster of villages. So that what you are providing are inter-village links. So in a sense, you're converting a set of villages into a mini town. That was his idea. So that you could then actually think of the urban informal guy shifting to that area. Yeah? People completely missed out on that. So it was not providing electricity and a road to the local mandi. It was really interconnecting villages and connecting that set of interconnects with the nearest sort of urban hub. That was the idea. And I think it's a good idea. But it's, let me also tell you, it's very expensive to do. Right? Just the economics of provisioning is makes it much easier and much less costly for me to provide basic amenities in a densely populated urban area than in a dispersed area. I mean, it's obvious. It's expensive. So if it is expensive, if you're paying more, then you need to ask yourself the question, what is the additional benefit I'm getting out of it? And that additional benefit must outweigh that additional cost.
Just on this last point, you said that for the informal economy, it is important that they have, you know, the politicians look upon that as some form of constituency. I think the problem with the informal economy is that they're not a source of revenue for the government. And many of the urban governance structures that you're talking about, that is important. So how are you going to bridge that problem of the informal economy?
Well, the point is, neither is your rural area a source of revenue. Look, let's accept facts. The source of revenue for all government, and Rohini is sitting there, he can give you the exact figures, is almost entirely formal urban India. That's where all your money comes from. Every penny, whether you're talking, no?
Not indirect taxes.
Oh, well, sales tax is a different thing. But then if my average rural person is consuming 62% agriculture, you don't have a sales tax on that. So you're not.
There is revenue, except it's not going to be urban looking body. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So they don't get property tax. They do get indirect tax, but they don't control that.
Yeah.
That's the problem.
Yeah, but that's not the thing. The point is that at the end of the day, what matters to the politician is also who's giving him his the votes.
60% in the rural sector, as you have defined.
But within the urban area, what happens? You know, the political dynamics of urban areas, I'm completely fuzzy about. I don't know. As I said, slum, qua slum, is relatively small, it's only 20%, so it doesn't create, one doesn't think of it as a vote bank. You then think of the middle class as being, lower middle class as being actually the dominant political category in urban areas. I don't know. And this is something people study urban areas.
Sorry, I'm pushing this a little bit further. The point I'm trying to make is that probably we'll be making an error if we think about the political economy giving rise to our thought process about the informal economy. I think unless we think in the way that you were saying that it's an intermediate step, right? That unless we think about it that way and try to release the constraint so that the transition is faster and smoother, right, which is really different from political economy. It's more about planning, more about, you know, you talked about education and healthcare. So focusing on that, which is spillovers also into the formal economy, right?
Sure.
So it doesn't matter.
Sure.
I think focusing there would be better than trying to think about the political economy that will get us.
That is true. But you know, at the end of the day, you cannot have a technocratic solution. Somebody has to ultimately sell it to the political wallahs. No, Niti Aayog.
Okay, at the back.
When you say that we have this unproductive informal economy, what that means is that within itself, the city, whatever part of it is formal, cannot support more than the jobs it is currently supporting, and therefore you have this informal sector, domestic servants, whatever it may be, depending on where it is. The question is that when you say put it at the heart of the economy, so it follows what Shivaji was saying, then why don't we just make it easier for the formal sector to grow and absorb some of these jobs? Because that's always going to be there. So when we say that we want to put the informal sector at the heart of the discussion, then are we really talking about giving them services and decreasing the decongestion economies, or are we talking about actually making the transition to the final step easier?
No, it is the transition to the final step. What we are saying in effect is the following. We know, for instance, that if you are thinking about skilled labor in India, the way it works is an unskilled person gets hired by an SSI unit, stays there 5 to 7 years, learns the job, then gets absorbed by a larger unit. This has been the process. And this process went along at a, you know, a fairly even pace while we were growing at 5.5-6%. Moment we accelerated to 7% plus, the ability of the small scale sector to provide those people, but it simply couldn't do so. And you started getting skill shortages appearing. So if you're going to be thinking about that, is it the final end product being the formal economy, if you haven't thought this through, you're going to run into roadblocks in getting there. That's the point.
One thing, apart from so many things that are going on, also caught my attention is that definition that we are using about what is urban versus what is rural. To me, that seems to be kind of a central thing in all this discussion, because if we now were able to change the definition, then the ability of providing services to different kinds of governance structure that we've been talking about, so if we can redefine what is urban instead of using the three parameters that we have in the census now and just looking at maybe density, then what is now rural would suddenly become urban, and therefore the governance structure might change and the services that we can provide will also change, right? And also maybe the politics of it.
No, I wish it was so simple, okay?
No.
The, what we have even at present, the recognition of census towns and the conversion of census towns into municipal areas can take as long as 20 years. Right? So even when they're formally in the census, recognizing them as urban areas, okay, with these three criteria, it can take 20 years for it to be converted into a municipal area. So it's now if I take it to the 70% level, it'll take me the next 50 years. I mean, I don't know how it will work.
No, but if we just...
But, so we need to actually discuss and debate the process by which you start formally and legally notifying areas as municipal areas,
right,
where governance structures do come in of a particular form.
Well, it's a pleasure to hear Pranab, whether in planning commission way back or later after so many years. The question here is of making the transition and focusing on the middle economy or the intermediate economy, which is what was the focus on. If you're translating this into very specific actions in terms of policy, I think we have answers, but perhaps we have forgotten them long back. If you look at the old princely towns, there used to be flower markets.
Mm-hmm.
There used to be vegetable markets constructed, well constructed, not ready wallas. Now, basically, I mean, if I've understood you correctly, what you're saying is make the transition as smooth, as human, and as skilling as possible, rather than the other way around, or just rather than ignoring. I'm not suggesting just that the Lee Hart kind of a solution, which is, of course, a good one. But
it's an eyewash.
It's an eyewash. I mean, yeah, it's a romantic solution. It's
yeah.
a good one, but fine, it has its place. But there is an answer. If you go to the older cities in India, including places like Trivandrum, a market was built way back just for selling vegetables.
Right.
This is true with Madras, Chennai. It is true with Bangalore, built by the king or whatever. But they were meant precisely to do this, to deal with, I mean, I don't think they conceptualize
this
it
is,
in
this
the way.
This is true, but you must also understand that provision of these kinds of things are very land intensive.
Absolutely.
All right? What has been happening in urban governance in India is land is being used very, very parsimoniously. Right? Today in urban India, the proportion of land which is public land is shrinking alarmingly. All of these things, you need those public lands. And you've given up on those. The kings didn't bother. All of that was public land as far as it was the king's land.
But they stopped thinking about
it. We've stopped thinking about it. They thought it through. That's the point. Yeah.
Okay, I think the questions have dried up when we are 2 minutes short of closing. So I must say that you've raised a whole sort of a lot of issues which raise other questions, and you've seen the questions that have come. So it has been a very stimulating evening and left us with room for thought and figuring out where we need to do things differently. So unless there is a formal vote of thanks by you, so then I'll hand you over to Shivaji for the closing ceremonies.
Thank you very much. Pranab started by saying that he felt a lot of pressure to kick off the series. I think the pressure worked. Indeed, it was a most fascinating and highly interesting exposition. I know that he's used his experience both in the Planning Commission as well as with the statistics that he was talking about. So it is now up to us to carry this thing forward. I fully agree with what he has said in terms of where probably we went wrong. There is actually some literature on the growth of towns and how they could develop. So unfortunately, we don't read those papers either in our syllabus or we don't talk about it. But this is a good forum to start bringing those papers up for everybody to be able to discuss these issues. So it was a great presentation, and I would like to thank him for that. Ninan, I'm sorry you did not could not put your questions in. But thank you very much. And thanks to all of you for staying back to listen to this very wonderful presentation. Thanks a lot.